So this morning we're continuing in this worship series called Following Jesus to the Cross, as we are literally following Jesus on his journey in his last days that led him to the cross, those events and those stories just before Jesus headed to the cross. So this morning, for your progressive gift, as I mentioned to the kids, we have the little beads, and those are olive wood beads. Now, you may not immediately recognize why we would give you olive wood, but by the end of this morning, you'll get the connection very closely. So we're going to look at the story of Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. And the term Gethsemane means olive press. So it is felt that there in Gethsemane, there was an olive orchard, and typically in the center of the orchard, you put an olive press that you crank it down and squeeze the oil out of the olives. What we'll find in this story and in this place called Gethsemane is that Jesus is pressed in the Garden of Gethsemane. And if you visit the Garden of Gethsemane even to today, there are these ancient olive wood trees, old, gnarled, beautiful trees. I had the opportunity to visit there, and these trees are at least 1,000 years old, because olive wood can be made from a cutting, maybe even the descendants of trees that were there when Jesus was pressed in the Garden of Gethsemane. So as I read this story of Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, I want you to try and picture what this was like, what it was like for Jesus there in the garden. I'm going to read the version that's from Matthew, the 26th chapter, following just a little bit after, in fact, the story we looked at last week, again from Matthew. So it starts, "Then Jesus went with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, 'Sit here while I go over there and pray.' And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee." These were the disciples that Jesus was closest with. "And he began to be grieved and agitated." Grieved and agitated. "And then he said to them, 'I am deeply grieved, even to death.'" There are those times, those crises in your life where it feels like you're going to die. And that's what it was like for Jesus there in the garden. He says to them, "Remain here and stay awake with me." We looked at this lesson a while back in terms of the support that Jesus needed from his disciples. And going a little further, he threw himself on the ground. He didn't just kneel down. He didn't just even crumple to the ground. He threw himself on the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me." Just prior to this, Jesus has instituted Holy Communion. He celebrated the Last Supper with his disciples, and he's told them, "Take this cup." This cup of wine represents and remembers that my blood will be poured out. But Jesus is saying to God, "If it's possible, let this cup of suffering pass from me. Yet not what I want, but what you want." Not what I want, but what you want. In the Gospel of Luke, there are a couple of details not contained in Matthew that fill this story out even a little bit more. In the Gospel of Luke, Luke records that an angel from heaven appeared to him and gave him strength. And then Luke was a physician, so he particularly includes this detail. "In his anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down on the ground. Well, this may have been poetic license that the sweat was pouring off of Jesus so profusely it was like blood dropping off of him. But Luke, being a physician, would have been aware that there is a condition where you can be so anxious, so upset, that the blood capillaries in your sweat glands burst and you could literally sweat blood. May have been how upset Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane. And Matthew continues, then he came to the disciples and found them sleeping. In contrast to the obedience that Jesus is wrestling with, they can't even stay awake to support Jesus. He said to Peter, so could you not stay awake with me 1 hour? Stay awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. Now, just as an aside, and all of you who are aging, which is pretty much all of us, can probably relate to this description. The older you get, at least for me, the more I feel like, yeah, the spirit is willing, but the body goes, not anymore, Stuart. You're not 20 or 30 or 40 anymore. That what your mind and your heart and your spirit say, your body is not willing to do. But this is significantly more. As Jesus reminds Peter, you know, what your spirit is willing to do, your body can't keep up with. And of course, that is true as well for Jesus. Jesus is wrestling with what his spirit says and that his body does not want to go to the cross. The text continues again. He went away for the second time and prayed, my Father, if this cannot pass unless I drink it, your will be done. He continues to wrestle with God. And again, he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy. So leaving them again, he went away and prayed for a third time, saying the same words. Jesus wrestling with obedience there in the garden. And then he came to the disciples and said to them, are you still sleeping and taking your rest? See, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. We'll look at this sense of betrayal. Get up, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand next week. This story of Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane has made many wonder and think and wrestle with what this was like. Many great artists have wondered and tried to capture what it was like for Jesus there in the Garden of Gethsemane. There's lots of wonderful art. I went and viewed some of that this week, trying to get a sense of Jesus there in the Garden of Gethsemane. In the movies that have been made about the life of Jesus, they've wondered and tried to capture what this was like for Jesus. I watched part of the movie The King of Kings, pretty good representation of what it might have been like for Jesus. I went and watched a scene from The Passion of the Christ. The writers and directors of that movie even imagine Satan there in the garden tempting Jesus. But I went and watched a scene that I thought captured really a lot of the emotion in the musical Jesus Christ Superstar. And I want to show you that scene. Setting-wise, there are no olive trees in this particular version, but in song version, I thought that the writers, the Andrew Lloyd Webber, did a great job of capturing the emotion of Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. So again, this is from Jesus Christ Superstar.
Why should I die? your omnipresent brain. Show me there's a reason for you wanting me to die. Far too keen on where and how, but not so hot on why.
Sad and tired. After all, I've tried for 3 years. Seems like 90. Why then am I scared to finish what I started? What you started? I didn't start it. God, thy will is hard, but you hold every card. I will drink your cup of poison. Nail me to your cross and break me. Before I change my mind.
So let's talk for a little bit about the obedience that we see in Jesus. I don't know of any better way to define obedience, at least obedience to God, than exactly the way that Scripture describes that wrestling with Jesus. When Jesus says, "Yet not what I want, but what you want." It's a perfect definition of obedience as Jesus is there wrestling. And we've all experienced that same feeling of what we want and what God wants. And sometimes wrestling even with what God wants, that it's not clear. Many times this is in small but significant ways, that as our life goes on, we sometimes wrestle with not doing the wrong thing or doing the right thing. And each of those small moments of obedience adds up in our lives. Will we get into trouble or not? Or will we pray? Or will we give? Or will we serve? Or will we read the Scriptures? Or will we worship? Again and again, we face these moments. Not what I want, but God, what you want. And sometimes as well, we end up in big situations where we wrestle with these questions of obedience. Sometimes it's ending or starting a relationship, or what career or job or where we will live. Or sometimes there are literally life and death situations. One of those times when I remember somebody sharing with me this very wrestling was a wonderful, wonderful woman I knew. She was a member of my first congregation out in Ohio. Her name was Harriet Strode. And Harriet was a polio survivor. In her early 20s, she was struck with polio, and at least when I got to know her, Harriet had no use of her legs, no use of her right hand, minimal use of her left hand. She could operate an electric wheelchair, and it was obvious that Harriet even had trouble holding her head upright. And yet she was such an amazing person, full of kindness and joy and faith. And she told me one time of the source of that faith. When she first got polio, they had to put her in an iron lung. If you're not familiar with polio, polio is a disease that attacked the muscles. Oftentimes, someone was so debilitated that the muscles that allow you to breathe were affected, and polio victims literally suffocated to death. And Harriet was in this situation. So they put her in an iron lung, which through the pressure was able to breathe artificially for a polio victim. A long metal tube, not unlike a casket, is where Harriet found herself in and out of consciousness. And she overheard the doctors and the nurses talking, and she realized how close she was to dying. And she said, trapped inside the iron lung, she found herself simply repeating Jesus' words in the garden. God, not what I want, but what you want. If you want to take my life, then take it. And if you want me to live, then keep me alive. I knew Harriet in her 70s, and so she had lasted 50 years with the results of polio from that time wrestling with obedience. Yet not what I want, but what you want. And I think as challenging as those times are, in a horrible situation like Harriet was in, or for any of us in moments of wrestling with obedience, or Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, it is good that we are pressed. It is good that we are challenged. Perhaps not unlike an olive in the Garden of Gethsemane press. Because it's in those times, in those moments, that our faith is built. It's never easy to be pressed with obedience, but it's in those moments when we truly have to wrestle. And I absolutely believed Harriet that that was when her faith was built, when she had to ask, not my will, but yours be done. And when we are pressed, when we have to wrestle with that question, that's when our faith is built. As you see the little olive wood beads on your progressive Lenten gift, let them be a reminder for you of obedience. To think about not what I want, but what you want, God. As we continue following Jesus on his journey and our journey to the cross. Amen.